are basically commercial films. I try to kind of layer it with a message. So basically, I studied to be an engineer, which is like totally strange. But then I went on to do my master in visual communication at IIT Bombay. And that basically gave me a perspective of various visual communication tools like designing, photography, filmmaking. And it was a two-year course. And my parents were wondering, after studying engineering, what am I doing? Studying designing and filmmaking. But that became my... I later on went on to do almost 200 hours of television content in all genres. These were basically television projects like Rishte and Gubbare on ZTV, then Krishna Arjun on Star, and so many other projects which I did for television. But what happened also was like I was getting a bit bored of the television because it was repetitive after some time. And also I came out of the closet as a gay man in 1990. For me, that was a turning point because like I was closeted, I had hidden my sexuality from everyone. And in 1990, when I came out of the closet and I joined Bombay Dost, which was India's first gay newsletter, my whole life changed completely. And then in 1994, I co-founded the Humsafar Trust, and I was a trustee for almost like, 20 years. So basically these things changed my outlook as to what I wanted to do. So I realized that the television industry was not giving enough space for any kind of stories about non-heterosexual, non-cis people. So I just said, like, we need to really make our own stories. Basically, since I was a gay man, I want to tell our own stories about our community. So I basically, along with my partner, Sagar Gupta, started in 2001, a production company, Solaris Pictures. Our main aim was to basically create a series of films, which was what we call advertainment, where we combine advocacy plus entertainment. So we decided to use this particular approach. Basically, when we create this advertainment, it means entertainment is the main quotient of the films I make, which is the top layer. And underneath that, we basically layer it with messages. So basically, people who watch these films take back something of a message of the topic of the particular thing. And using my engineering background, we treated filmmaking as a process using various ingredients to evoke certain reactions, what I call engineering emotions. I feel that every person, when they see a film, certain emotions are triggered. And a filmmaker, if he's a good filmmaker, can trigger those emotions in a good way or a bad way. So we're going to find out that per se. And with my company, Solaris Pictures, we have made till now 6 films. Pink Mirror was the first film, which was made in 2003. It was India's first film on drag queens. 2003 basically was still, things were very much in the closet. So the film got banned by the censor board. It's still not clear. Then I made Yuvasha Moshri, 68 pages for the film on HIV/AIDS, Purple Skies and Breaking Free for 2 documentary films. So Breaking Free won the National Award for Best Editing. Purple Skies became the first ever lesbian film to be shown on Doordarshan. And most recent film is Evening Shadows. I'm going to talk a little bit about Evening Shadows per se. Evening Shadows is a heartwarming story about a mother coming to terms with her son's sexuality. It's set in a small town. It's right now streaming on Netflix. And it has won 24 International Award, screened at 75 Film Festival. But here, basically, more than the son's dilemma of coming out to his mother, the film is more focused about the mother coming to terms with her son's sexuality and how she struggles to accept her. So I'm going to show you basically a trailer of the film so that you get an idea as to, 1 second. Yeah.
कौसल्या सुप्रजा राम पूर्वा संध्या प्रवर्तते उत्तिष्ठ नरशार्दूल कर्तव्यं दैवमान्धिकम् कौसल्या सुप्रजा राम पूर्वा संध्या
वसु वो आ रहा है ना वरना उसके अपने घर के पूजा में मेहमान उससे पहले यहाँ होंगे
ये सब क्या है मुझे नहीं करनी कोई शादी वादी
पूजा के लिए आए हो ना
बस।
नीला तुम्हें पसंद है? ये सुनो।
नो।
करेक्ट टाइम पर शादी मतलब करेक्ट टाइम पर बच्चा। बाप जब तक रिटायर होने के लिए तैयार है, बच्चा को जॉब मिल जाता है, वो फैमिली का रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज उठाने के लिए तैयार है। इतना सिंपल कैलकुलेशन समझ में नहीं आता है तुम्हें?
अभी तो छोटा है ये।
बस इस बारे में मुझे कोई बात नहीं सुननी है।
तो दक्षिणा में देने वाला शॉल का
अंदर होगा,
यहाँ क्यों नहीं है? इसमें मुझे बताना पड़ेगा।
करना, भाग्य में जो लिखा होता है ना, उसे कोई बदल नहीं सकता।
हम अपना भाग्य खुद लिखते हैं अम्मा। तुम्हें कुछ बताना है?
तुम्हारा सीक्रेट?
I'm gay. मुझे लड़कियों में कोई इंटरेस्ट ही नहीं। मैं एक लड़के से प्यार करता हूँ, अमन से।
जानती नहीं थी तुम, जवाब देना आसान था मेरे लिए।
So that was the trailer of the film Evening Shadows, which is right now on Netflix. You can go and watch it. And that's the thing. And of course, my other films are also available online. Purple Skies is available on YouTube. But right now, I'm going to basically shift my focus to the main topic today, which is filmmaking. And I'm going to start talking about it per se. So one of the things was... So one of the things also, like what we did was basically as part of the outreach for the film Evening Shadows, we created a group called Speak Out, the Rainbow Parents. These are parents of LGBTQ children. So, and they have almost 100 members right now spread across various parts of India and outside India too. They helped parents deal with issues of acceptance. And the reason I'm going to be talking about this is like to find a purpose for the films you make. That's the reason this particular slide is there. And also, like, I mean, in between, I also, in 2009, the Delhi High Court read down 377. So Kashish Mumbai International Queer Film Festival, we started in 2010. And it became the first ever film festival to be held in a mainstream space. And from 2010 to 2021, we have been holding Kashish Film Festival for the last 12 years. It's usually held in Liberty Cinema, but last 2 years has been online. What is interesting is like they're almost like we always say, where are the LGBTQ cinemas from India? But we get almost 30-35 films which we show every year from India. And Kashish basically has also been nurturing filmmaking. So it's not just exhibiting the films at the film festival, but also facilitating screening of the films at other festivals around the world. And also like providing 2 lakh rupees to one filmmaker to make their next film. So I just want to jump into the main thing. Basically, what are the right ingredients for a good advocacy film? So I would imagine that most of you coming from different backgrounds, we would want to make a film. Of course, you want to make an entertaining film, but also I would say that you would want to basically... Yeah. So basically, like, you'll be... Yeah. So what is like sensitivity about... So sensitivity about the subject matter is really important, whatever subject matter you choose, whether it's about environment or cancer or payment, whatever, that's the main thing. And I would say like deeper understanding of the subject is really important. So what is this? Sorry, can I just stop share and come back to this? I don't know what's... Yeah, there's some problem with it. Yeah. Then also, like, I mean, when you make a film about any issue, I would say that, like, you need to look at the universality of the subject matter or how we can present a film with a universal message. I mean, usually, so that it appeals to a larger audience. If I make a film on a gay subject and only focus on the same thing, then it might not appeal to a larger audience. Like, Evening Shadows basically focuses on the family. So it universalizes the subject matter. And then, of course, you need to make a good script. We're going to talk about it later. Then you need to find sensitive collaborators, which is the cast and crew. And of course, you need to find funding. And that's a big challenge per se. And you need to build a good buzz and social media presence and find a distribution potential. So we're going to break up all these into different points per se. Yeah. So steps for developing a film. I'm looking at, like, I would imagine that you'd want to do a short film of around 15 minutes or something. So the basic steps would be, first you need to have an idea and story. Then you need to develop the script. Then you need to get into pre-production, then production and post-production and distribution. I know it seems like a lot of steps, but if you follow these, I'm sure you'll make a really good film. So developing the script. An idea or a concept is only good if it's developed into a good script. You might get an idea today saying that, like, okay, I'm traveling by train, I'm speaking to somebody next to me, and it's a good story. But that could be a good concept, but you need to basically develop it into a story. How do you make it appealing to a larger audience? So it's best to do research on the subject matter you're doing, and also talk to people around the subject matter. Suppose you're doing a film on environment. So I would say that, like, do a lot of research on the topic you're doing about the environment. And also persons, so that you get a clearer understanding. And it's not just one idea. You have to, when you make a universal story, you need to create many ideas together. Like, for example, the character of Vasudha in the film Evening Shadows. Basically, it's about one mother who basically is finding a challenge to accept her son. But the Vasudha we have created is an amalgamation of many parents whom I met on my way, you know, and basically all their different stories are put together so that, like, we have one Vasudha who embodies all these different parents' ideas. You know? Then the following steps is basically, once you develop the script, you need to do a one-page story. Usually when you have a story, you want to start writing it, but people always have a block about writing it. But you need, the only way to go about making a film is to have to kind of means or something. You just have to basically tell your story the way you narrate it to a friend. That's a one-page story. Then you would actually do a step outline, what's called a step outline, where you basically break the story into scenes. I mean, like, when you say a scene, basically, like, if I'm sitting at home and I'm traveling to a place, so my scene one would be my home, and then there's a scene two, which is the train or the auto rickshaw where I'm traveling. Then three is where I reach the point where I'm supposed to reach, and four is when I have a conversation with somebody. So you need to break up this story into a step outline. And then comes the whole script, which is going to be like 15 to 20 pages for a 15 minute film. Usually, like, a one page denotes 1 minute in a film, usually if it's written in the correct format. And so you would basically, here you're going to be writing in detail about the scene, where is it set, what are the kind of, who are the actors, who are the characters, and everything, and also the dialogues. So all this will become part of the script, which is going to be your Bible when you come out to shoot the film. So then pre-production, you need to get, once you've got your script ready, and basically I would say, when you have a script ready, I would say run it through some of your friends. Don't hold it close to your chest. Read it out to some friends, or give it to some friends to read it so that they can give feedback. So when you develop a script, sometimes you can develop it in like 2 months. Sometimes it takes like 7 years to develop a film, you know? So take your time till you're sure that your script is ready for pre-production. So funding, of course, is the biggest challenge, but speak to your friends, colleagues to donate money to you for project. Do a crowdfunding campaign. You can always start a crowdfunding campaign and invite, but it's a lot of effort because you need to be a good social media influencer to gather money through a crowdfunding campaign. Then you need to find a good producer. So a producer need not be an investor. People think that producer is somebody who's going to be investing money. No, Producer is somebody who can manage the project, you know. So because you as a writer or director cannot manage everything. So you need to find a good producer who will stand by you in good and bad and basically execute the project. Then, of course, casting, finding the right actress to play each part. So I would suggest that, like, you should audition the people. And when I audition for basically my gay or transgender stories, I try to kind of audition people from the community. So there's this whole debate right now going on about non-trans people playing trans characters on screen. So I believe that, like, a transgender, real-life transgender person should be given equal opportunity to audition. And if you find they're the right choice, we'll definitely go for them. Or we basically workshop with them to make them ready for the final acting process. Then finding a technical crew, finding the right camera person, sound recordist, production designer, makeup hair. So I'm going to basically giving all this so that we are talking about a fiction film. Of course, if you're making a documentary film or an educational film, the process is different, but most of these steps are still there. I would still say that you need to find a producer. I would still say you need to find a good technical crew. Maybe you don't need the makeup and hair or a production designer, but I would still say, don't go and shoot it yourself. Hire a camera person, hire a sound recordist. I'll come to that. And of course, location is find the location you need. And always consult your camera person and producer when you finalize the locations. And production. So scheduling. So you need to be sure that, like, how when you have like 20 a page script, you might have around 30 scenes. So how do you schedule these scenes? They need not be shot, obviously, in chronological order. You might shoot the middle scene first, you know. So scheduling according to the location and the day and night thing and the availability of cars is really key. So if you make a good schedule, 80% of your issues is solved on the sets. And since I'm an engineer and I believe in logic, so I make a really good schedule and I really basically finish all my films in time and in the lowest budget possible. And equipment, apart from getting on board good technicians, important to hire equipment suitable to your project. You can go with a DSLR camera, you can even, or a big camera, but like you need to make sure that like the camera and the light and sound equipment you choose is correct for your particular project. And never compromise on your vision. And always be alert. Basically, if you have a script, make sure that you adhere to the script. Make sure that everybody is rehearsed in advance so that you don't waste time on the sets. And also backup. This is something really, really important. Always backup your shoot to hard drives. People just don't pay attention. These are very small detail, but really important that you need to backup your shoot and keep it in two different hard drives so that if one gets corrupted or one gets lost, at least you have another backup per se. Next is post-production. Sometimes I take 20 maybe shoot, depending on the number of locations and number of scenes per se. And once you've shot the film, you need to get into post-production. So you need to find a good editor. So these are key people, basically the camera person, the sound recordist, and a good editor are key people whom you just have to get on board. So if you don't have connections in the industry, I would say go to a media college. There are a lot of students from media colleges who are ready to help out. So find them and you can basically give them a small honorarium or a gift and they'll be ready to help you out. But make sure you have a good editor and a good camera person and a sound recordist. Then the sound mixing. So you always, sometimes when you're shooting, you're more focused on the visuals, but never forget the sound because that's really the most important thing because films are an audiovisual medium. You need to hear the sound and also see the visuals. So you need to make sure that the sound mixing is really good so that you can highlight the dialogues and the sound effects and also bring out the silences. Silences are really important in the film. Don't fill your film with dialogues all the time. Then music, the right background score adds emotions of its own that you know already. And color grading, that's something I would really recommend that get a cool, good color grader who can basically spice up your output per se. So then of course, like once you have the film ready and you're shown it to some of your friends, made the corrections and edits and everything, and you have the final output ready, so the next system would be the distribution. So film festivals, submit to the film festivals suited to your film genre. Millions of film festivals across the world. So even if you have a film on environment, there are, like, I would say 200 film festivals focus only on the environment, not just in India, but across the world. And whatever the topic of your film is, basically you can find a resonance with film festivals across the world. There's a film platform, film festival, a submission platform called Film Freeway. You can look at it and put it out there free, and you can distribute it across the film festivals. Then community screenings, gather people around who believe in your topic and show these films. Because for me, once you make the film, to be seen is the most important thing, you know? Then OTT platform, try to get your film on any of the OTT platforms. It's a difficult challenge for a short film, but you can definitely try. I basically made my own way. My first film, Gulabi Aina, was on Netflix, and then Breaking Free was Netflix. So you have to push the doors, and the doors will open for you for sure. Or you can put it on YouTube so more audiences can see it. And of course, you're the filmmaker and you know the film the best. So don't ever shy from promoting your film. So at every given opportunity, talk about your film. If you're going to a party, talk about your film. If you're going to a conference, talk about your film. If you're in the classroom, talk about your film. Because, and also, like, create a Facebook page and an Instagram page so that you can promote your film better. And of course, last is plan your film, obviously. That's the next thing. Once you've completed this and the film is successful, plan your film. And so this is my Twitter handles, etc. You can talk about it. So thank you. So what we can do is, like, we can take some questions right now. Whoever the participants are, any questions, if you're putting it, like, if you can speak out, or you can put it in the chat box and I can definitely see the questions. Any questions about my own work or filmmaking process, anything is welcome. I basically have graduated from, I used to make film on hearing impairment and cancer. So I've also come out of the same thing, same school of filmmaking, where I started making short films on cancer and hearing impairment, and then basically graduated television projects, and now finally graduated to making feature films. So every person has a filmmaker within them, and each one of you can be a filmmaker yourself. So any question is welcome. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Hi. So. Yeah, hi. You have spoken in a broad perspective where you need a crew or a setup or a studio.
Yes. Hi, just give me 1 minute. I need to switch.
Yes. Yeah.
Preeti, are you there? Preeti? Gargi, are you there? Thank you. Please go on, sorry.
Yes. So, yes, sir, as I was saying, what you have spoken is on the broader perspective, where you have a team, where you have a crew, or you have a studio to create everything. So as I alone, so I'm still studying and I want to document. So I'm studying wildlife studies. So imagine I want to document wildlife, or I have to bring fiction through wildlife. So no one has done it yet. So for that and all, what would you suggest for young people like us? Where to start, and any suggestions?
So I would say that, you have an idea. I would say put it into a story first. First of all, don't think that, like, you have the idea in your head and you can go and shoot, even if you shoot on a mobile phone, but I'm sure that, like, you can basically put, if you're a filmmaker, you have to be a writer, or you can hire a writer, you can get a friend. You don't have to hire, obviously, you can get a friend to collaborate with you. And write out the scenes, write out, if you're just a documentary filmmaker, write out even the treatment, I would say, how the film starts. You have it in your mind for sure, but I would always say put it down on the paper and make it and go through the same script 5 or 6 times, share it with friends, make it perfect, this is perfect to shoot. And then, of course, if you don't have a crew or something, you can still shoot on your mobile phone. But I'm saying, make sure that you have good sound, So when you shoot on your mobile phone, if you're shooting an interview with somebody, you are at a distance from that person, So I would say that, you shoot from your mobile phone, but also ask them, the person whom you're interviewing, to record on their camera, on their phone, the same audio. So they just put their phone on their pocket and ask them to switch it on and put it on a voice recorder there, so that you have a good sound right where the person is. Otherwise, the distance between you and the person will basically muffle the sound out, you know. So these are small tricks you can definitely employ, you know? Okay. And also, like, make sure that, like, when you're going to shoot, make sure what time of the day you're going to go out to shoot, you know. Morning, early morning is the best to shoot environment, of course, you know. Okay. And afternoons are really bad because of the harsh sunlight, you know. So avoid afternoons if you can manage to do that. Early mornings and late evenings are the best time to shoot the whatever. Even if you're shooting on a mobile phone, I would say be conscious of the light. Okay, be conscious of the light. And also, like, I mean, if you're having if you're having actors to play certain parts, you can go through the same process. I would say put out a call for audition on your social media page. And I'm sure at least 10 people will turn up, even if it's an unknown filmmaker, because people are dying to work, you know. So, and also, like, I mean, there's no harm in choosing actors from your own circle of friends. But basically, you need to make sure that they will play the part, they look the part correctly. Sometimes the casting is so bad, you have an elderly person playing a younger person or a younger person playing an elderly person without proper makeup, and it'll all look shabby. So you need to make sure that you cast correctly, you know. And then, of course, even if you don't cast the right person, you can always train that person to perform, you know. So these are some of the things you need to learn. And of course, nowadays you can edit on your phone, but I would still recommend. Also, what happens is, like, there are, of course, many film festivals which are basically showing iPhone films only, mobile phone films only. But if you want to basically go into the next level of having your film for bigger film festivals, you know, I would say hire a, I mean, you can get a friend who has a DSLR camera instead of a phone, you know, and basically hire a small mic or buy a small mic. And these are the basic things. I would say good visual and good sound would be the best thing. Then, of course, editing, you can always have on your Nisa Fair. You can do it yourself. You don't have to bother about color grading and all. Just that's for the professional quality. But I'm sure you can make it. But as I said, the first thing would be a good script. Even if it's a documentary, you need to write out the treatment and make a good script. Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. And we have one question from the audience. Akanksha, if you could.
Yeah. Hello, sir. I'm a freelance journalist. And I also want to make a film film on nature, on nature, travel. So, sir, first of all, our budget is a problem. So, how do we raise the budget? Because as a freelance journalist, we have less sources. तो बजट कैसे रेज करो, और सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट चीज सर एडिटिंग ऐप के लिए, अगर हम मोबाइल से एडिट करते हैं तो विदाउट आईफोन और आईपैड कौन सा ऐप हमारे लिए बेटर होगा एडिट के लिए?
ओके, सो बेसिकली द थिंग इज, लाइक, पैसा तो सबके लिए चाहिए होता है, बट आप बिल्कुल कम से कम पैसे में कर सकते हैं, कोई इसमें नहीं है. जैसे, लाइक, आप अपने दोस्तों को, जितना दोस्तों को आप मोटिवेट कर सकते हैं अपने प्रोजेक्ट के लिए, यू नो, सो अगर आपके प्रोजेक्ट अच्छा है तो काफी लोग आपके साथ जुड़ेंगे. सो जितने लोगों को आप मोटिवेट करेंगे उतना आपका कॉस्ट कम पड़ता जाएगा, यू नो. सो ऑलमोस्ट आप जीरो कॉस्ट से फिल्म बना सकते हैं अगर आप फोन से बनाएंगे तो. आई मीन, आपको क्या चाहिए, मतलब अगर आपका कास्ट, अगर फिक्शन कर रहे हैं आप तो कास्ट होंगे, तो उनके लिए बेसिकली आप ऐसा कास्ट को ढूंढेंगे जहां जो पैसा नहीं लेंगे, या आप बोल सकते हैं बाद में जब पैसा मिलेगा तो मैं आपको दे दूंगा. एंड ऑफकोर्स जो बाद में चाय पानी नाश्ता खाने का खर्चा होता है वो, और ट्रैवल का खर्चा होता है, उतना ही खर्चा होता है आपको, यू नो, बिकॉज आप फोन से अगर शूट कर रहे हैं. बट आई वुड स्टिल से कि आप थोड़ा सा पैसा इन्वेस्ट करके एक गुड माइक जरूर खरीद ले, या भाड़े पे ले उसको, बिकॉज आई वुड से दैट, लाइक, एज आई सेड, लाइक, साउंड इज रियली इंपॉर्टेंट. डोंट इग्नोर साउंड, यू नो, इवन इफ यू शूटिंग ऑन योर मोबाइल फोन. ये बात है. एंड दूसरा क्वेश्चन तो मुझे मालूम नहीं, बिकॉज मैं एक्चुअली फोन पे एडिट नहीं करता हूँ, तो मुझे एप्स मालूम नहीं, अनफॉर्चुनेटली, बिकॉज मैं हमेशा डेस्कटॉप पे करता हूँ और एडिटिंग सॉफ्टवेयर से करता हूँ. मुझे मालूम नहीं कि आपको ढूंढना पड़ेगा ऑनलाइन. बट आप जैसा, मेरा पहला प्रोजेक्ट जो था गुलाबी आईना, हमने उसको बनाया था 2 लाख रुपया में, नो, ओके. और बट लाइक वो भी ऑफकोर्स आपके लिए बहुत ज्यादा लगेगा, ऑफकोर्स, बिकॉज हमने प्रोफेशनल एक्टर्स किया. बट हमने वो 40 मिनट का फिल्म बनाए थे, और वो फिल्म बाद में 2013 में बनाए थे, बाद में वो फेस्टिवल्स में गया एक्सेट्रा, बट 2015 में वो नेटफ्लिक्स पे डिस्ट्रीब्यूट हुआ एंड हमें बिल्कुल ऑलमोस्ट 12 लाख रुपया मिला. सो आप 2 लाख रुपया इन्वेस्ट करेंगे तो शायद आपको 12 लाख मिल सकती है. वैसे ही बता रहा हूँ, यू नो, बट आई एम सेइंग कि जो भी काम के लिए थोड़ा सा आपको इन्वेस्टमेंट करना पड़ेगा, अगर 50,000 हो या 25,000 हो, एंड उसके लिए आपको अपने दोस्तों से या अपने फैमिली से अपने पैसों से बनती है, कोई फंडिंग नहीं मिलता उसके लिए, अपने पैसों से, अपने दोस्तों के पैसे से, या हम जैसा फ्रीलांस जर्नलिस्ट है तो आप वो काम करके थोड़ा सा पैसा जोड़ के अपने फिल्म बनाएंगे, वो पैशन प्रोजेक्ट होती है। जैसे मैं अपना फिल्म जब बनाया तो मैं टेलीविजन प्रोजेक्ट करता था, उसमें जो पैसा मिलता था उसको इकट्ठा किया मैंने, यू नो, जो सेव किया उसको, उससे मैंने अपना पहला इंडिपेंडेंट फिल्म बनाया, यू नो। सो आपको थोड़ा सा डेफिनेटली जैसा 25,000 या 50,000 या 1,00,000 रुपये में आप आसानी से बना सकते हैं फिल्म, यू नो। बट जैसा मैं बोला कि आपको अपने दोस्तों को जोड़ना पड़ेगा और एक अच्छे से स्टोरी और स्क्रिप्ट तैयार करना पड़ेगा और लोगों को मोटिवेट करना पड़ेगा।
थैंक यू सो
सर। इफ आई कैन ऐड ऑन टू योर पॉइंट, सो देयर आर फ्यू सॉफ्टवेयर्स फॉर मोबाइल आल्सो, प्रीमियर प्रो हैज रश, एंड देन देयर आर इनशॉट एंड फिल्मोरा एंड ऑल, बट दे हैव स्मॉल वाटरमार्क, सो इफ यू हैव लिटिल मनी, इफ यू कैन बाय इट, यू कैन यूज इट विदाउट द
वाटरमार्क इन शॉट्स।
Okay, nice. In short, yeah, even that is also good for entry-level video editing stuff.
Thank you.
And Sundeep Narwani has a question. And
sure.
Yes.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity. I wanted to ask, how does one sell a documentary to Netflix? As in, can you just tell me two things mainly? One is, how does one approach? And second is, what are their benchmarks like, you know, in terms of the production value? What will they buy? And if I may add one more question, like, do you negotiate with them? You said 12, but, you know, is it that they have a standard offer price, or, you know, again, they look at the length of the movie and perhaps how many awards it has won, and then, you know, the movie gets more money from them?
Yeah. So basically the thing is like, you're talking about mainly Netflix, but there are many OTT platforms, of course. Netflix basically like, when I sold my first film, I didn't negotiate because for me it was a surprise. I made the film in 2002. And when it got sold in 2015, I was like overjoyed. I didn't negotiate at that point of time. But my second film, Breaking Free, was a documentary film which was went on to Netflix, you know, and it stayed there for 3 years. So when you go to, and usually you don't go to Netflix directly, you can go to the aggregator. So there are various aggregators like Vista India, okay, Tulsia. Vista, you can just check Vista India and you can go to them and you send them your film. And they basically try to sell it to all the OTT platforms. And whoever gives the best bid, they will come back to you and say, is this price okay for you? Okay, and not just the price, but how long your film will be on a platform. Sometimes it'll be for 1 year, sometimes it'll be for 3 years, sometimes it's 5 years, no? And whether it's going to be an exclusive or non-exclusive. But right now, it's going to be difficult to sell documentaries on Netflix. Frankly, that's been my recent. So when they entered India market, they were more open to buying documentaries. But right now, they're only commissioning their own documentaries. And I don't think they're buying new documentaries. Same with Amazon, unfortunately. So that's just my thought, but you can still try. You can go to Vista and try to kind of talk to them and send your screener, and definitely you can pursue the matter. But I would say that like you can, for a documentary, it's going to be more challenging because of finding a platform is going to be much more challenging and monetizing your film. Okay, you can put it on so many different platforms, but to get the money back, that's going to be a challenge per se, yeah.
Thank you. If I can ask one more question to the moderator.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So I want to ask you, with the new guidelines for the new media laws coming in and the censorship coming, what do you think how does that impact documentary makers like you, you know, who perhaps want to talk about very edgy issues? Edgy from the perspective of the government. So how do you navigate that space now? Are you going to be thinking differently?
So, yeah, definitely. I mean, earlier there was a censor board, which basically kind of rated feature films for cinematic distribution. Now there's a committee or the new guidelines. So I would say that like most of the guidelines are right now very safe. They basically are focused on more highly political or highly religious kind of content right now. But you don't know when it's going to kind of change and clampdown will happen on other sensitive subjects. I just hope no, but like one can never say. So definitely when I'm making my film, I don't think I'll look at the whole idea of the censorship or the how it will go. I'll make the film to the true value of what I believe in the film, you know. Then, of course, I mean, the film Breaking Free was submitted to the censor board. They gave it an A certificate. They asked me to bleep off. But something like Evening Shadows, I submitted to the censor board and they gave it an A certificate first, you know, because anything to do with homosexuality is supposed to be an adult certificate, you know. But I argued with the team members and I said, this is such a clean film. It's about the mother and the son relationship, you know. There's not, it's a family film. So finally, when I argued it, they gave it a UA certificate and that helped me go further with my work. So basically, when you make a film, I don't think you should worry about how the rating would happen, all that right now. Just make your film. And then, of course, you can always tweak it. If you feel that like, okay, I need to reach out to a larger audience, maybe you can delete some scenes or something later. But first, make your film to the truest of your vision, I would say that, you know.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Anyone else has anything to ask?
I'll ask a question, sir.
Yeah.
So how did you came across that you want to make a film? Is any qualities we can see that, yes, I can make a film, or it's just a passion which was there from childhood?
So for me, as I said, like, I mean, I've taken some routes which I never thought I will take, some paths which I never thought I'll take. So I studied to be an engineer. Till then, there was no idea that I want to be a filmmaker at all. You know, when I went to my master's in IIT Bombay, which is about visual communication, there basically one of the topics was filmmaking. You know, for me, that suddenly started my interest. You know, and then basically I did that particular short film course, and then I went to Film and Television Institute of India (FTII), and I did a film appreciation course. That basically gave me a whole perspective as to filmmaking, you know. See, what you have to do is, like, for me, one is, like, as a filmmaker, you need to have your ideas that, okay, I want to make a film, you know. But also, you need to be studying all films across the world, you know. You have to open your eyes and see more films from the, not just from the master's point of view, but from the master's. I mean, I would say study cinema, you know. I think you can do it online. You can watch, if you go to YouTube, and put Godard or Tarkovsky, you can find so many different films, or Mani Kaul, or Satyajit Ray, or Ritvik Ghatak. You can find so many films, and I would say, see this film repeatedly. The first viewing always it would be just as an audience. You will see that film just as an audience. If you see a Ritvik Ghatak film, you'll first see it as an audience. But if you see it again, okay, you'll find different aspects of it, you know. So I would say that, like, I mean, basically passion is the main thing which drives me. So I could have, after I finished my course from IIT Bombay, I could have been a graphic designer. I was a graphic designer for almost 3 years, but I shifted to film. So if you have a passion, you'll slowly navigate to it. You know, there's no special qualities. But as I said, like, everybody can be a filmmaker, but everybody has to learn to be a filmmaker. You need to basically teach yourself that, I mean, as I said, like the whole points which I mentioned in my thing, you need to go through each of those processes. Don't skip a process, you know. You need to basically go through writing the story. You need to go through writing the step outline. You need to go through writing the script. So I would say that, like, if you're a passionate filmmaker, you'll go through all these steps, you know, and to make a good film. So you need to, everybody can be a good filmmaker, but you need to learn to be a good filmmaker through studying or through watching. That's what I would say.
Thank you, sir.
And as I said, I never wanted to be a filmmaker. I basically studied to be an engineer. So what am I doing? But it basically grew out of the thing. And also my other directions have been very interesting, that, like, after film, after I graduated and I was doing designing, then I shifted to filmmaking. Then I assisted. Also, the other thing is, you can, if you're really passionate, assist good filmmakers, you know, okay. That'll help you learn your craft. So you could be a complete newbie, but when you work with somebody, you will open a lot of, not just ideas, but also open doors. You will have contact with the camera person. You will have contact as a sound recordist. All of them can help you with your next project, you know. So I would say I went through the long route. I assisted filmmakers like Sai Paranjpe and Kalpana Ajmi for almost 6 years, you know. Then I did television projects. And then suddenly out of the television project, I found my own niche to make LGBTQ cinema. So it's been very different paths for me, and I've taken those paths. So I would say, when you take your new path fearlessly. Don't think about the end result. So if you find a new path, just go on it, and definitely you'll find a rainbow at the end of the horizon. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
So we have another a minute to go.
Yes, we will stop by.
Yeah. Any last questions from the audience?
Okay. Thank you, Preeti, for interpreting. Thanks a lot, Hitesh. Bye bye. Thank you, everybody, for joining in the session.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.